Hello everyone. Now it's time to put this all together. In this video I'm going to review key takeaways from all the theorists talk about. So here goes. Taking a look at Shore's evidence based on imaging results, he states that the real self is first developed through the right orbital cortex of the infant's brain. Remember, an infant isn't born with higher brain functions and they are strictly working off emotion. The mother object acts as the baby's higher functions as a self-regulating object. Think of the self as beginning behind your right eye. Now, the right orbital frontal cortex lies on top of the limbic system, and it works with other areas of the brain in complex ways, and therefore has far more than just one role, but the best way to describe it is as emotions. Furthermore, a part of the limbic system called the hippocampus helps us form and retain memories, which is very important for learning and development. What is key here is that the self-regulating other is responsible for soothing the infant, while the brain is growing and forming connections. Later, the infant will internalize the self-regulating object to form a self. As the baby grows into a toddler, and hits what is called the rapprochement crisis, or terrible twos, the brain is still growing and making crucial connections in concert with the limbic system, whereby the autonomic nervous system is at odds, parasympathetic, and sympathetic. So you can see here how the baby's temperament would also play a pivotal role. From a neurobiological perspective, it's the first 3 years of critical periods of growth, specifically the brain, that lay down patterns of behavior and relating for the rest of our lives. So, you heard me mention Mahler's rapprochement crisis, and will often hear Masterson refer to her separation individuation model of psychological development. What's most interesting, is that he finds this model so extremely useful, but not for the reasons one might think. He infers that this model is helpful in pathological development mostly, and cites her research subjects as pathological infants rather than normal based on review of her own research. History is important here, because most of her work was done in psychiatric hospitals on what she called psychotic infants, and when he broke down the research, he found that over half her subjects, including the mother subjects, were displaying signs of borderline, or narcissistic personality disorder characteristics. As the leading expert on pathologies of this sort, again, he cites that her work is most helpful in this area. I also talked about Daniel Stern, and how his model of development was formed by many layers. What's most interesting in his model is that he asserts that infants are pre-wired to develop, have an innate will towards independence, and it's not single dramatic moments that shape the personality, but small moments over time. Furthermore, Stern would be the one to coin the phrases attunements and purposeful misattunements. The first is a sort of validation between the mother-baby dyad, and the second would be purposeful in correcting and guiding the child. These layers and attunements would be the basis of his psychoanalysis and his approach to therapy. Then there's Heinz Kohut and Otto Kernberg, both who were leading experts in narcissistic personality disorder, but broke from one another with differing views on the subject. Mainly, Kernberg viewed narcissism as a highly dangerous disorder, coining the term malignant narcissism, and Kohut taking a much softer approach, saying that narcissism is necessary for one's well-being. Interestingly, Kernberg fled Nazi Germany, having witnessed firsthand the true evils of malignant narcissism, and died at the early age of 61, which allowed Kohut the opportunity to create the prevailing view on narcissism. Moreover, Kohut would be the founder of self-psychology, where empathy and validation seem to be the cure for most disorders of the self. Lastly, are the attachment theorists, Bowlby. Mary Ainsworth would later do an excellent research study, called The Strange Situation, where, for 3-minute intervals, a stranger would be introduced to mother and baby and the corresponding behaviors of the baby would be noted. There would later be a sensational study done by Harry Harlow studying the attachment of rhesus monkeys, which were then later translated to human behavior. Was it ethical? Not likely, so I don't think you'll see that study repeated. What's most interesting about attachment research is that the researchers are going strictly on human behavior and not imagining what's going on in the infant's psyche. After all, no one can really know what's going on in someone's head, with the exception of affect, or the experience of, or feeling of emotion. Throughout all of the theories, affect is the guide which psychologists and researchers alike make their inferences, diagnosis, and assumptions about what is going on in someone's mind. Secure attachment is said to be observed through displays of positive affect. So transactions of affect are what they are observing to determine the intrapsychic features of a human being, infants and adults alike. Disturbances in affect could be the result of a non-attuned mother, and failure as a self-regulating object. Or, it could be the result of a pathology already in place. Masterson states that pathology occurs in the first year of life. He does not use arrest in development, but says this should be something in its own category, pathological development. He is also noted, based on both neurobiological and Mahler's developmental model, that there are critical periods for growth of the self and baby, during the practicing subphase around 12 to 18 months, and again during the rapprochement crisis around 14 to 24 months. At this time the child will find the solution to the crisis through object constancy, but at the same time is at the height of narcissism, and alternatively shame, a neurobiological process that acts to inhibit behavior, develops. Obviously, here is where splitting and grandiosity were to develop. But Masterson negates this by saying that splitting and grandiosity are not internal, intrapsychic processes, but rather an identification with a parent. Is he suggesting the child identifies with the pathological parent? Or takes on a learned behavior? This I have yet to clarify for myself. So interesting. So you can see, and most theorists and researchers agree, including Freud, that the personality and this elusive thing we call the self is forged in the first 3 years of life. I would hope most of you by now, with all this information, really feel for a toddler. My goodness, the stuff that's going on with them, as they are struggling to figure out the world while their bodies are attempting to reach a sort of homeostasis while their nervous systems are fine-tuning. Phew. No wonder they have tantrums. Also, you can see how important the self-regulating others are, since the infant does not possess higher brain functions. A non-attuned mother, or a mother other who is deliberately abusive and neglectful, can do massive amounts of damage to the real, or core self. And that brings me to the selves, or false self. What is that anyway? The false self is said to be a construction of a self, by the infant to please the mother. And that makes sense when you think about a narcissist, doesn't it? In my experience, one can observe an NPD and see they have weak object constancy, and the false self, mask or persona is to please everything external that would get them the supply they need. In contrast though, what is the true self or real self? This is a concept developed to describe the experience of being alive, a sense that life is worth living. Finally, the point is, in the study of psychopathology, there is a split in the real self, and trying to identify and correct this split is what people like Masterson do. Somewhere in the first 3 years, or sooner, the false self has taken over, and lives for all things external, and I would go on to say that this contributes to the pathological personality reports of feeling empty and desperate, never being able to fill it up and feel whole. This leads to what Masterson calls abandonment depression seen in his patients, and this is something that the splitting defense tries to avoid at all cost. Does that make sense? I do hope this expanding your information on narcissism to help you make sense of not only what is wrong with the toxic V person in your life, but to help you take a look at your own patterns of behavior that might have led you to this monster to begin with. If you have any questions at all, please feel free to ask. As always, love to all, and I hope you're having peace of mind living narc-free. I know I am.